But then in the background, Jay DeMarcus is trying to produce the band. Like, he wants to be the producer, right? So I'm being snapped at every turn. There is, I'm being undercut constantly. And I, you know, I never say that. I've been in the room with fucking Motorhead, you know? And I've been in the room with Ice-T and Body Count. These guys are nobodies. They're just three guys from Nashville, but they kicked the shit out of me. I got completely, I'm never going back there.
Hey, it's Joe West from the West Pond with
Mike Shimshack.
Today, we've got the one and only Howard Benson on. You may know him as an epic rock producer, but he's actually a materials engineer who's worked on C5s and F-18s, which is such an odd front roll story to anybody who works at a recording studio. I found that completely fascinating. But as with all things, he eventually got pulled into his true calling, which is making records. And he's made so many records that we all have identified with in epic records of our, you know, what we remember whole summers by, including POD, Cold, Crazy Town, My Chemical Romance, All American Rejects, Hoobastank, Flyleaf, Daughtry, Seether, Third Day, Rascal Flatts, Kelly Clarkson, Santana, Skillet. It goes on and on and on. He's continually been a part of great records, which I think, man, that's, there is something to this. When you've been doing it for 30 years and you look back at the people that have succeeded, there's something that's always in common, and it's an undeniable will to continue and to keep on via just like waves on a beach, showing up every day and making great records. So welcome to the show, Mr. Howard Benson.
Thanks for having me. My wife says hi, by the way.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Monica published my very first song ever.
That's right.
Yeah. Tell her I said hello. She's awesome. Yeah.
How awesome. So you got a musical family, it seems.
Yeah. I mean, I grew up at, I don't know if it was musical. My mom was a music teacher. So I learned, I listened to her play piano. And when I was growing up, I didn't really learn that much piano from her. It sort of was a band I joined that I kind of, you know, one of those high school, not even high school, junior high school bands. And just, we had some keyboards in the basement, old pump SD organs. And I thought that was a combo organ at the time. I didn't know what it was, but they showed up, and that was how my career, that's how I started, kind of like, it was just one of those junior high school dumb band ideas that you get, you know? So, you know.
Doing a little research for this, looking back at some of your history, I was on the Flyleaf record that you did. So A&M Octone put out a record for a great rock band called Flyleaf. I had mixed their EP. A lot of those songs went on to the big record that you did that was a multi-million seller. And then I had done some other record stuff with them that they included on, like, is like separate. I did Tina and produced a couple of tracks on that record that they put kind of your record. And then I guess put some more specialty stuff on it.
Right.
But I remember listening to that record, having done the EP, and being like, what a band, what a great band. And then hearing it through the lens of another producer, you could really feel that there was direction there. It's like you had honored the band, but you had taken them to a sound that was just completely identifiable. That record has such a sound to it. And it was like,
you know, it's funny. You know, James, the NR guy, James Diener, who signed them, actually was ready to drop them. And he called me. I was in the middle of my chemical run. I was in the middle of a lot of shit at that point. It was 2005. And I think if you look at my resume, I was doing like 10 records a year, like full albums.
You were the king, man.
Yeah. I invented the assembly line record making process. So, but anyway, so he gave them to me and he goes, oh, go see them at the Roxy. And I actually dug up these. I said, I have them. I found these Roxy pictures of them. And I called him back and I said, hey, if you ever want me to produce a band that's this bad, don't ask me to see them. I mean, they were awful at the rock. There was nobody there. And the drummer was, he's a great guy, the drummer and all that, but he wasn't a drummer. And, you know, the guitar players were playing in different worlds. The bass player was jumping around like a crazy person. And she, there was something about her that was magnetic, but she was, at the time, she was just dressed in jeans and there wasn't anything there really, right? But they did have a song called Sick that had this like nursery rhyme melody to it. And I remember I said to James, listen, he said, I don't want to spend any money on this project. It's like, I'll give you, at the time, $75,000 for the record, which is nothing back then, you know? And I liked James a lot. And I saw there was something about the band that I thought, and I also was kind of in the Christian rock world a little bit with POD and stuff like that, and Blindside. And, you know, there is a business there back then, and there was a really good business there. And, you know, all these things kind of were happening in my head, and I was like, all right, I'll work with these guys. And I remember delivering Sick to James, and he couldn't believe there was song. I don't think he realized how good they actually were. I don't think they knew how good they actually were. I think they were just some band from Texas that just sort of wasn't aware of the record business. They were so green. I have a picture of them at Mates in rehearsal with them sitting on the drum riser. They look so, she still has little like schoolgirl glasses on, and it's so innocent looking, you know? And to see what happened after that, what blew, you know, after we made that record, because looking back, there were some great songs on that record, like, you know,
Fully Alive.
Fully Alive. And, you know, it was pretty, one thing I'll say about her, what she sang, you know, it was Lacey Sturm singing. There was no doubt that. And she had one of those she came at the right moment. It was a little bit before Hailstorm, but after Evanescence, there was still like a void of female rock singers. And that actually inspired me to do Hailstorm, because another band that was about to be dropped, actually, that I was in Craig Kalman's office and I was having a meeting about something else. And I saw that, you know, there's an upside down sheet. It says drop list.
Jesus.
Oh, my. You have to look at that. Right. You know, like who's getting dropped, you know? And I remember looking at it. I'm sorry for going tangentially here, but I'm looking at this drop sheet and I see Hailstorm. And I knew these kids from Philadelphia because that's where I'm from, right? And I went, how can you drop them? They're from the hometown, my hometown. You can't drop them. And they toured all over. They were kids at the time. And I said, hey, I'll do this. Look, don't drop these guys. I'll do it. And I knew Bill McGaffey was the manager, and he was a great manager. But I found out later they'd been living in the Oak Woods out here for like 2 years trying to write songs. Never could write any songs. Never had the right hookups. Their A&R guy I ended up getting Pete Gambarg, who was not working there yet at Atlantic. I had done Daughtry with him. So I brought him in as a A&R associate, and he actually helped with the songwriting, getting the writers together. And so so I started doing more and more female oriented artists. I did Kelly Clarkson after that. It was something I think Flyleaf might've been the first band I worked on that had a female singer actually. And, you know, it was real interesting because you have to rethink everything on the keyboard. Like where is the, you know, you can't exist in E and E flat all the time. You know, you've got to worry about different keys with female singers. So it was a learning process, but it really paid off down the line. So she was kind of a guinea pig for me, Lacey, a little bit, you know.
Well, and that band in particular didn't really have radio, which was crucial then.
No.
And that record, to have a record that doesn't have radio support but sells a million copies, that says something about the record and about them supporting the record.
And didn't we love MTV back then? Mm-hmm. Yeah. We actually hated them until they played your record, and then we loved them. But they were like sort of one of those alternative ways to get them out there. And I think that's where they really shined, was on TRL and all those shows that played those videos and everything. So Octane, I think, liked them. I think Sirius was coming into its own at that point. So they got a little bit of love from Sirius Radio. But you're right. It wasn't like Flyleaf wasn't like one of those bands that was, you know, Shinedown or 3 Days Grace or bands like that that have massive. Right. I mean, they could piss on the tape and it goes to number one. Doesn't even matter anymore. So, you know, Flyleaf had a struggle. They had to earn it.
Yeah, I can remember that after they had that record, they ended up pulling into Nashville and doing, I did an all acoustic version of that record.
Right.
We just went through and did a bunch of acoustic stuff, but they were on such a mind melting schedule that one of the guys got married and they only had the weekend off.
I remember that. Remember that exact time that happened. Yeah.
And I went out to Bridgestone. They played Bridgestone when they were in town, and I couldn't get over the jumping off of double stacks. These kids, like at 50 years old, you know, I'm careful the way I walk downstairs because I don't want to grind my ankle into powder.
Yeah.
These guys were jumping at Bridgestone off the top of double stack Marshalls.
Well, the bass player was crazy.
It was like
that guy.
You see him in the studio, you don't get that part of him. But no, then you go to see him live and you're like, it's like Cirque du Soleil. But yeah, beautiful record. And I also was, you have been able to change, metamorphosize into different genres depending on what you needed to do to provide for your family. I was listening to you talk about how you were finishing a hairband record and then you guys saw Nirvana, Smells Like Teen Spirit come on, and you were like, oh my God. And you were, but you were able to pivot. You were able to pivot into this new world and always continually find a way to provide for yourself and staying in the arts. Tell me what that is. That just a business acumen, or are you legitimately excited? You've done Kelly Clarkson, you've done Rascal Flatts, you've done, you know, Skillet.
I learned a lot during the hairband era, watching, which I thought were groundbreaking. They're not giving enough credit, these guys like Tom Werman and Bo Hill and guys like that, who really were great producers, Michael Wagner. They were just in the hairband world, and I got in the hairband world late to the party. So my records, like, I didn't really get that shot to have platinum albums. I think the first album I did that did what okay was Bang Tango, but that was even close to the end of the. So by the time 91 rolled around, which was Nirvana, I remember I was in the studio with Little Caesar doing their second album. I remember looking at the TV and seeing this guy with a mop, you know, and turning up the fader where the TV was on the SSL, and hearing that song. And I turned to Ron and I went, we're fucked. Like, I remember that. And that's the second time that happened in 5 years, because before that, when I was doing like Metal Blade records, I remember Guns N' Roses had come on in 1986. And I had the same reaction, that we're fucked. And because back then there was just one channel for everything. Like, you know, if that channel changed channels, you're out. And the other thing that happened then too, which most people don't seem to remember, that was the same year that SoundScan started to record actual sales. So the week that SoundScan changed their list, and I remember it was in October 1990 or something like that. It's right during their Nirvana world. The top 200 records were Warrant, Winger, Motley Crue, those records. Then all of a sudden, real numbers started coming from retail stores that were scanned numbers. Who was the number selling artist? I bet you don't know. It's a trivia question.
What year is this?
Garth Brooks.
Oh, wow.
Had ever heard of Garth Brooks, but he was selling all these records. But because you could work this, remember back then, if you paid Billboard enough money, the chart was a combination of how much did you pay based on record numbers. Hmm. So there wasn't a real chart. It was I don't know what you would call it, like a hyped up chart. Now it's a real chart. So for the longest time,
SoundScan would do this thing where they weighted stores. So if they said, hey, we're only monitoring these stores. So if you bought it at Bob's record store in New Jersey, we're betting that you also bought it at these 10 that we're not monitoring. So we're going to give Bob's
record store a weighting of 10. Yeah. So, I mean, anyway, so lots of stuff changed. And I remember thinking, I need to change because I don't want to be Bo Hill. Not that I don't want to be them, but I don't want their career. Like, I could see that they were, boom, typecast. So I went to Austin at South by Southwest. I think it was the third year. There was like nobody there. And I looked for an alternative rock band, you know, because I knew I needed something that Rick Rubin was doing. Or I remember George Draculius were the producers that were doing those things. And I got lucky. I literally went into the first door and there was a band called Seed there. And they sounded like those bands. Like, I didn't know who these guys were. All I know is, wow, it sounded like Smells Like Teen Spirit to me. Or close to that. You know, four guys not dressed with long hair, but dressed like shitty. And okay. You know, like, and everything is macro to me at that point. Like, okay, this works. Okay. So I got them eventually. It's a long story, but I got them signed to Giant Records. And it took a lot of that was probably a pretty pivotal point in my career, because not creatively, but business-wise, I learned a lot about the business in those 2 or 3 years, because I almost got blown out of that project. I finally got it signed to Giant. I wasn't really a successful producer. I ended up working for Irving Azoff. They hired me as their head of A&R. Why? I have no idea, because I didn't know anything about A&R. But Irving just hated his A&R department and he wanted to fuck them. I was happened to be the person around that he could fuck them with. So I end up working there and learning about and watching Irving make deals, you know, work the business with phones. And it was like this other side of the, you never see this as a producer. It's the other side of the desk, you know?
Right.
And I worked there for 2 years and I learned so much about not recording music, but how the process of music becomes made. And that really influenced how I made records after that. Like I realized that, you know, you can't be living in this, but I remember I had this about 5 years later, maybe six, after I started having some big hit records, I had these, a meeting with a bunch of publishers and it was me and two other producers on the stage and we're giving a talk. And they said, so what is your main goal as being a record producer? And, you know, I think it was, who's that guy who does the second Nirvana record in Utero, you know,
Steve Albini.
Yeah. It was like Albini and the guy who did Korn as well. I forget his name, but they're like foo-foo producers. Like it's all about the creativeness. It's about the art. Oh my God. We hate the record company. You know, like, you know, everybody's fucking full of shit, but us, you know, that kind of thing. So they're talking about those things and they get to me and they go, what's your job as a producer? I said, my job is to make fuck money for the band and record company. That's the job. I'm supposed to score points. And if I don't score points, I don't care how friendly I am with this band, they won't hire me again. But if I score points and they hate my guts, I'll still be in this chair next time. And all these publishers came up to me and went, finally, somebody said something for real here, you know? And that came from working at Giant, from actually watching that hope. Because I remember we'd sit in these Wednesday meetings and, you know, those are always the days you have those record companies meetings are Wednesday. Because, okay, what did radio do the 2 days before that? Let's talk about the radio. Let's talk about marketing. Let's talk about what's going to happen to these new artists. Okay, play new music. You put on your music and if nobody in that table reacts, you're fucked. Like right then, all the time you spent making that record is over. And you then realize as a record producer, you kind of engineer it backwards, reverse engineer it and go, wait a second, man, what I got to make sure that Wednesday meeting goes well. And so while I'm making the records now, I'm always thinking you can't unring the bell with these projects. Once you ring the bell and you send them something and they don't like it, they don't like it. I don't care how many more Wednesday meetings you have when they play that same song over and over again, you're fucked. You're not getting the marketing budget. You're not getting the radio budget. You're not getting any of this shit. And you don't care. So now, obviously, it's a different world we live in because of it's more easy to get your music out there. But, you know, that was a big deal for me.
Going back to the origin of this question, which is you going through all these genres and doing a Kelly Clarkson record, Rascal Flatts, and then POD, you still find joy in the making of any genre of record. You can. It's not you're not just doing this thing for A&R. You're finding a way to be an artist within the confines.
Yeah, yeah. Although I got to say, country, the Rascal Flatts record convinced me I ain't doing no country records anymore.
Oh, you got to tell us why.
I, that was of all the records I did. I feel like I walked.
I wish you could have heard the buzz around Nashville that Howard Benson was producing Rascal Flatts.
Well, there you go. See, that's exactly the problem, right? I came in. I think it was kind of like, I didn't realize what I was getting into here. I didn't know the players. I didn't know, like in rock music, I know the players, right? So I know who's playing the defensive backfield. I know the linebackers. I know all that stuff. I walk into Nashville. The first thing is and I love Scott Borchetta and he took me under his wing, but then I become a carpetbagger, right? Because, and they hate in the background, fuck this guy, you know? And I'm taking meetings with, you know, in my world, we have a bunch of writers there. I'm sitting in these writing sessions. And it was hilarious. They go, okay, we're going to listen to songs today. I'm like, okay, we'll listen to like 3 or 4 songs. No, we're sitting in this conference table and all these publishers are coming in one after the other. I think I have a list still. It's 120 songs we listed in one day. And that's what they do down there. It's like this crazy, and you can't tell at the end of the day what's a good song anymore. Because they're all about the same thing. It's all the same stuff. Everybody's got the best thing. The band, the three of them, we had a shrink. The guy on the Metallica video.
Oh, my God.
Guy, no way.
If you watch. he was with us during the project because they couldn't get along, the three of them. Now, I liked them all. They were nice guys. But my first meeting, they're packing guns. And this, and I'm realizing that this is not Rascal Flatts as I thought they were Rascal Flatts. I mean, they all have, they fucking hate each other. The two of them hate, the two of them, the brother, the, I mean, Jay and the cousin. They both want to be on the Jodan. No, Jodan's the one who's in the middle because he's not related to either one of them.
Oh, yeah. So Gary LaVox.
So he's trying to just keep his job, you know. The other two are related somehow. And Gary goes, well, without me, there wouldn't be no Rascal Flatts. And with that, and Jay goes, I found you, fucking guy from Ohio. Without me, there would be no Rascal Flatts. So it became, song selection became a political, it was like literally electing an official, you know. It was who can select. That's why when I remember hearing about their other producer, like, you know, Life is a Highway, all this stuff. These things happen by accident, almost a lot of these songs, because the band has no song sense at all. They don't. They're produced. What was their producer who produced all that shit?
Mark Bright and Dan Huff.
Oh my God. I give those guys so much credit. I could not, you know, it's like if they tried to produce like, you know, 3 Days Grace, they'd have no shot at that. I came in to the Super Bowl and got my ass kicked. It was 49-0 at halftime, you know? And the managers are all in cahoots with each other and they hate, and they're, I remember they walked in and I said to one of them, I said, so what do you think of these songs? Well, it's your fucking job to pick the songs, man. I said, well, wait a minute, who's A&R in the project? Well, nobody A&Rs anything. It's all the producers have complete.
That's Nashville, man.
Yeah, so I'm thinking there's an A&R. Nobody's explaining this to me, any of it. And I'm a seasoned producer at this point. I've sold a lot of records. But then in the background, Jay DeMarcus is trying to produce the band. Like he wants to be the producer, right? So I'm being snapped at every turn. There is, I'm being undercut constantly. And I, you know, I never say that. I've been in the room with fucking Motorhead, you know? and I've been in the room with Ice-T and Body Count. These guys are nobodies. They're just three guys from Nashville, but they kicked the shit out of me. I got completely, I'm never going back there.
That's wild. I mean, after
never
all
going
the,
back.
You have, it's as the, a producer, you grow all these incestuous. Muscles. You grow all these muscles to deal with all the cancer that can come into a recording session. And to hear you say that about the Nashville process, you know, it's stunning. It's stunning.
And you know what I realized
too? Different economy.
Well, somebody said to me, you don't go to, the problem is, you're leaving for the weekend. I said, so what do you mean? He goes, you know what? You need to go to church on Sunday. I said, well, I'm Jewish, but I'll go. I mean, if you think it's important, like at that point, I'm reaching for shit, you know? And they said, because what happens is everybody meets at church and everybody talks and nobody can fuck each other because they see each other every Sunday. So there's this built in, you know, stop fucking me thing because you're going to see that person every Sunday. You fly back to L.A., and all they do is go to church and talk about you, you know? And so by the time you're back on Monday, you're screwed. And I'm like, and I could feel it. And the manager was horrible to me. The man, I forget the guy who was, but he absolutely did not want me in this project. He just did not want. First of all, it started badly because I don't think they really wanted to make a rock record. They said they wanted to, but once we started to make it, they panicked and said, we need to make a Rascal Flatts record. So, and I've learned that lesson down the line when bands say we want to change and you go, yeah, sure you do. Until we hit, you know, the first chord and then you're going to go, why does this guitar sound different? Well, that's what you wanted, you know? Well, not really. So I get that out of the way fast, but I really genuinely thought maybe that's what they wanted because at the time rock was, you know, I think it was Florida Georgia Line was blowing up and that's what they were looking at. And by the way, Rascal Flatts was going like this at that point. So I kind of got him on a downside. It was, I had fun just because the stories are kind of funny. Like now they're looking back, but at the time I was suffering for sure. I was stressed, so stressed out. That's the most stressed out I think I've ever been in years. It was during that.
And you did that record in LA, right?
Some of it. And then we had to go back there because everybody had an agenda. You know, Jay wanted his studio used so he could charge back his studio costs, you know, and then Jodan had something going on because he had to play golf in every golf course in the country. You know, there was a golf tournament every day that we had to play around. Right. There was shit going on all the time. There was Gary went out to the farm and disappeared. We couldn't find him. It was like, wait a minute. I thought these were three homesome guys that I was going to produce.
How did you get the gig?
Scott Borchetta called my manager. I forget. I mean, look, Scott was busy as hell with Taylor Swift at the time. He wasn't really part of it that much. I mean, he was good to me and everything. And by the way, each of them were cool guys, but I don't think the three of them, they had a internal issue that was impossible for me to handle. What really needed to happen was Jay was going to take over that project, and he did. That was where it was headed. And I think in some ways I encouraged him to do. I could see about halfway through, I said, guys, I don't know why you need a producer. I just don't. But they're so used to that producer thing, you know, like there has to be a producer. And I remember saying to Jay, why don't you, let's just be honest with each other. Just produce it. You know, like just take over the project, you do it. And I think he ended up doing that. I only did 5 or 6 songs, and I was so glad to get out of there. I remember Hatch and I, my engineer, when we were flying back from there, we looked at each other and we were like, oh my God, like we're never coming back to this town. Like I love LA. In fact, I think that all the people that left LA to Nashville, go stay, goodbye, goodbye, stay. You know, I like it. We have way more. I think that's the B team over there. They all went there because they couldn't find work here. Right. You know, so if you got, and you know what, LA is tougher in a lot of ways because there is no, you got to, it's completely capitalist secure. You got to survive. You got to eat what you shoot, you know? So I don't know. I know this tempo of this town better, you know? So yeah, it was not going
so
back.
When you were finishing that part of the record, let's say when you got to the mixing stage, by the time you were done with that record, I guess you had an idea of what you wanted to put out, right? You had an idea of what this was going to be. And of course you correct course along the way. When you were printing final mixes for that record, were you like disappointed in them, or were you like, this is not what I wanted
to
do?
I had no say over it after that point. They gave it to some mixer guy. Gotcha. I wanted Chris Lordalgie to mix it, and they gave it to some guy they were used to. I forget his name, who it was.
But well, I remember hearing that record because me and Mike were pitching songs for that record, you know, desperately trying to get on. Rascal Flatts is such a vocal range that it's not standard that the vocal range in Nashville is much more limited. Kenny Chesney maybe sings within a fifth of, you know, it's rare for him to go up to an octave.
Right.
So you're writing specialty songs, delivering them, hoping they'll get cut. And I remember hearing Howard Benson is doing the record. And I'm thinking, well, geez, why can't wait to hear this record? When it came back and I heard the record, I didn't hear the Howard Benson in it.
They took it out.
I expected it to be sounding very differently.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't have been able to tell you that it was even done out of Nashville by the time it was all said and done.
Yeah.
I was excited to hear that record.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I didn't know we absolutely had to have a fiddle, and we absolutely had to have a, you know, slide guitar, and we absolutely had to have a mandolin. I didn't know about any of that. Right. Like we had to put that on there. We literally brought people in to put that stuff on because I remember the manager goes, well, where's the fiddle? I was like, what do you mean? Why do we need a fiddle? These are rock songs. Well, you need, you know, and Chris Lordalgie warned me of this. He goes, look, he goes, when I get these tracks in back in the day, the fiddle's always on track 12. The mandolin's always on track 13. And the slide guitar's on track 14. And this, you know, all the stuff that Nashville has to have is on these particular tracks. And he goes, if when you go there, they're going to force you to put these parts on there. And I remember thinking that, come on, what are you talking about? They're bringing me in. You know, but that's what ended up happening, you know?
Yeah.
So everything was, and then everybody was friends with friends who brought these friends in. And I was disoriented. So even mixing wise, it was out of my, I had no chance.
I guess part of the consequence of being a band that is that big in a genre is that the fear of not delivering a known quantity maybe supersedes the ability to cut new ground.
That's exactly right. And you know what? They actually were right about that. They should have not hired me. That was a mistake. They should have stuck. You know, the one thing I can tell you is that I've learned from my rock bands, you take your lane you've invented and you keep that lane. Like you make that lane and you keep the Foreigners out. You know what I mean? And the Michigas out. You want to make that your lane. But these guys panicked and they said, well, no, we got to do rock because of Florida Georgia Line. Let's go to this lane. And I don't think that was the right move. But like, if I was them, I probably would not have hired me to do the record. I think it was, I could tell almost half, not even halfway, about a quarter of the way through that they probably should have done it with Dan. I mean, mm-hmm. Dan's a great producer. Look, this is why 3 Days Grace keeps working with me, because we have something that works between us. You know, I do multiple records. If you see my resume of the same band, you know, that's rare, but I keep doing them. And it's because we found a lane and we got it, you know? So I think you're right. They should have stuck to their own thing.
So when you started having troubles, like when it started to rear its head in the studio and you're like, wait a minute, this feels like it's going to be a problem. How did those conversations go? Did you push hard and say, hey, look, I need to be a part of figuring out. You want to know something?
I tried to, and they didn't return my phone calls. They didn't. I would call Joe Don. He never called back. I remember trying to call Jay. They just were in their own worlds. Mm-hmm. That wasn't part of the conversation. You didn't have that conversation.
How about in the studio where something arose where it was just like a parting of the ways? Was it just like, how did you solve those issues? Or did you
don't think they felt they could talk to me, and I didn't think I could talk to them.
Interesting.
I really don't have that with any of my artists. Like that's really
comfortable.
Well, we were just, I think they felt, I know that they knew that their label wanted them to make this rock record too. Cause you know, Borchetta is a rock. He loves rock bands and he wanted to make a rock record. And I don't think they were on thin ice at the label as well. I think they just had been dropped by Disney at that time.
Disney went away, I think. Yeah.
Or they went away. They felt vulnerable. So I think in looking at it from their perspective, they were just probably really nervous about what could happen if like they let me go or told me this is not working, you know, which they should have done because it really wasn't working that well. We had a couple of good tracks on there, but you know, I know when things are working in there.
Right.
And it's not like I need the money. I didn't care. I mean, I cared about the money, but I didn't care. You know, I think there was one other album I did called Red Jumpsuit Apparatus where we had the same issue where the band internally, the band was so messed up that it wasn't about us, but it was about them. And this case was also about them. They just, the three of them had no communication between them. That's why I had the therapist there, you know, they're paying the therapist more than I was getting paid, you know,
dude, what was it? Different Monster, the documentary with
Some Kind of Monster.
Oh my, I mean, I watched that like I watched like a YouTube viral video because it was such, that band was, Metallica was imploding and it was on camera and I was watching it just mortified that they would have those kinds of discussions in the studio with that sensei dude. It was like, it was the best reality TV I've ever seen.
We were imploding too. When we were at Sunset Sound, we couldn't find the singer.
Wow.
I think he just flew home actually because him and Jay just couldn't get, they just couldn't get along, you know, but then they would get along it. You know, then they wouldn't get along. So I didn't know what was going on, you know, and they're both, look, individually, they're great guys. I liked actually hanging out. I actually went shooting with Gary. I never shot anything. I think he took me out to his range and I hung out with Jay and his wife and Joe Don and his wife, and they're all nice. But I think what's going on with them at that point in their career, 12 years on, they had so many personal obligations, so much drama, kid problems, the usual stuff, you know, and a producer flying in from Hollywood wanted, it was just crazy, you know? Yeah. So
I think it's really mature too, for you to be like, hey, I'm not the guy for this.
Yeah.
You should do this, finish it. I mean,
at the time I wasn't really sure what to say, but it's hard to say that.
At a certain point as a creator, you need to just say, hey, look, this isn't working. For me to work, we have to have a certain level of trust and we have to be able to negotiate how we're going to make this creative output of this record. And whenever that falls apart, I mean, it takes a real mature guy to say, look, I'm not the guy for this.
You know, I tried to do something else too. I'm just recalling this. I tried to pick more songs to record and not, I didn't even charge them for them. I decided to kind of just pick three or four that I liked and I got them to kind of demo them up. And, you know, that I thought was something I would do in rock music. I would just say to the band, write some more songs or let's go record some more stuff and we'll just see if it works out, right? Not realizing that it was costing them money because of, you know, again, there were certain things they were paying for, like Jay's studio and stuff like that. Even though I wasn't getting paid for it, I thought, okay, I'm doing my job here. I'm finding more material. I don't agree with your choices. Let's try this, you know? But they weren't down for that because it didn't, the three of them didn't agree on them.
Right.
Like it was my call what they were. So without the politics involved, they were dead on arrival, those songs. You
know? The politics protected sort of the procedure.
Yeah. And then the label got pissed off because they were like, how come we don't have a single? I was like, well, wait a minute. You've heard everything. I'm trying to record more stuff. You know, at least, and again, I think it's a culture clash between the two. It was a LA culture of, we were, By the way, it also came down to the chord sheets. I'm going, hey, let's go from C to F to D minor to G. They're like, what's that? I said, well, they're going, you mean 1-4-2-5? I was like, okay, we'll talk that way then, you know? But then I'm having to think completely in a different way, you know? And you get to Nashville and I'm saying, okay, why don't we start a little earlier today at 9? No, we don't start at 9. We start at 10. Well, let's start a little earlier so we can know. Yeah, nice. So we're getting on a roll. 1 o'clock, boom, stop. We have to have lunch, you know?
Right.
2 o'clock, boom, 5 o'clock, we're done. Well, why don't we work into the evening? We're having a great vocal. So I'm like, well, wait a minute. I usually don't start to 1 anyway, but I'm trying to fit into this culture here. And I didn't even know it was like that, you know? So all this shit was happening really fast. And, you know, it was crazy. My manager actually had to fly down there, which I've never had her do. She never had to do that once in any session, 20 years. She had to stop, come down and like, you know, take me out to dinner and calm me down, you know? So I felt so out of control, you know?
It's important.
I was probably like Captain Quig in the Kane Mutiny, you know?
Hey, you know, there is a certain amount of like decorum where it's like if you want to get the best out of your producer, just selfishly, you have to make sure that you engage them and make them a part so that you can get what's good out of them, right?
Well, they didn't think like, they were not like, no.
They didn't care.
They didn't care, no. I'll say that. That's interesting you say that because I've never really heard it said like that, but most of my artists are, I think in the back of their minds, they know that, you know, but these guys were in their own heads. I mean, they were a big friggin' band, right? Okay. They're a
band
huge
of the decade.
Band. They play tons of big, massive shows. I'm just like a fly that came into the house that's got to get swatted to them, you know? I mean, they don't look at anybody as being bigger than them. So, and I also think that was also hurting them a little because they were not, you know, what's we spent a week on? Are we getting invited to the CMAs? Oh my God, are we getting invited to the CMAs? We're getting invited to the CMAs. We're getting invited to the CMAs. I'm like, I don't even want to go to the fucking Grammys. What do you care? Like, who cares? But it means a lot, which I didn't realize, to be invited to the CMAs, show up, and then you sell records. It's meaningful. It's not meaningful here at all.
I think that I learned moving from New York City, where I was kind of responsible to do everything, manhandle every record, fix everything that came in. Every time you brought up a fader, you were pissed off at the tracking engineer, right? I came from that environment to Nashville. And what I learned in Nashville was like going back to the producer having value is if I manhandled a musician, they would give me what I asked them for, but they would do it like they were typing it into a typewriter sentence for sentence for me.
Right.
But once I just started to hire the right guys that I respected and then give them a lot of leash, I got things that were better than had I manhandled them, you know?
I completely agree.
And I think producers exactly are the same mean. Way. Let you get a fire under your vision and then decide whether it's going to work. Maybe you miss out on 50 grand and you decide the record's not a good record, but at least you gave it an organic shot of being what it was supposed to be.
No, they weren't like that with me. They tried to stop things at every, I mean, especially the bass player. He wanted.
Why didn't
to be
they have him
record.
Produce it? Why after all these years?
You know what? They should have. I mean, he wanted them to, and they wouldn't.
But that's also not a Nashville thing. You know that.
That's
Joe.
Exactly right.
It's like, you know,
well, you know, Jay
there's structure
just,
here.
Jay yeah. has been on the cusp of being a producer continually. He's producing
exactly.
all these records, all these other things. You see, oh, like I'm not going to get the record because Jay's got it over at his place. You know, people that are coming to me to talk about doing records, and it's like, why on earth wouldn't he get a shot at producing? You know, I knew, you know, Butch Vig and Garbage, and you get bands where the people are the dude from Boston, Schultz from Boston,
right?
The band Boston. It's like, why wouldn't they give that guy a shot to just do the record? Why waste Howard Benson's time if they're just going to have him?
I don't think Scott believed in him at the time. That's Scott. And I think the band issues. You know what it was? Now I know what it was. Joe Don and Gary wouldn't allow it. It would be too much power in Jay's hands. So
here's the other little dirty secret that no one talks about. Everybody's so desperate to have success that when they finally have the success, and if you have it in a group, whether it be a songwriting partner like Lennon McCartney, or whether it be in a band like Rascal Flatts, they all have issues with who's going to be the reason for that success.
Right.
And they secretly hate each other because they can't fully claim maybe, hey, I want recognized. And then it becomes this thing where you're sibling rivalries and you're supposed to be this band trying to do an impossible thing where the music is the center of it. So they get so many things get demolished because they don't honor the intention of we're people pursuing this greatness. People are
so stupid with that part of it. You know, I've had the same team of guys for a long time, the loyal, you know, Mike and Chris and, you know, Hatch and Mike, Paul, the guys I've worked with, because every time I do interviews, I always give them all the credit. Like, I don't need the credit. I remember Zemeckis. I remember, you know, I read an article about Zemeckis and Spielberg. And Zemeckis, after Back to the Future, he had directed all those films. And he goes, you know, what do you think about your success with Back to the Future? And he goes, well, my mentor was Steven Spielberg, and I learned everything from him, and I really give him a lot of credit for my directing style. And then I read later that he does that a lot on purpose because you know he's the director, okay? You don't need to go any further than that. So my name's on the back as the producer. I don't have to, I mean, you would think Rascal Flatts would be smart enough, right? They're in the band, you know? Right. Like, they're the band. Like, what else do you have to do here? You know,
the band,
like,
produces every record. We don't need it on the back of the label.
Yeah.
We know this. It's like, well, there's a reason you're working with them, because they're great. They're going to bring so many production ideas that's just intrinsic.
Absolutely.
That's the responsibility of the band, to get to the level where they're working with you as a producer. Why does it need to say produced by Motorhead and Howard Benson?
There's an amazing quote that I heard that I absolutely love. It says, a lion doesn't have to tell you he's a lion.
Yeah.
It's like, that's it. It's like, everyone knows Howard Benson's a rock god. And here you are giving all of the stuff to Mike Plotnikoff and all the, but, you know, I'm sure Mike is incredible, but we all know Howard's god.
Right. Or like, Shep Gordon would say, as long as they spell your name right on the check.
I was going to say, Chuck Cannon, a famous songwriter in town, has said, told me once, it's surprising how much money you can make in the music business if you don't care who gets the credit. And that always stuck with me as well. And I'll tell you what, when that Rascal Flatts record came back, I went and listened to it because I knew you did it. And that's the true test. It's like, for me, it's like, I'm following a guy like you because I know your fingerprint and I want to see what your chocolate and peanut butter did, your mixture. I wanted to hear your signature sound. I already knew that your records have a sound that I'm interested in, you know, and that's what you can, the more you scream for attention, the more people look to see why you're doing it, maybe, and look around you to see where the real talent is.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you,
destroyed Rascal Flatts here.
Let's move on.
We're going to need to clip out the middle.
I don't think I've ever really said that to anybody, that story though, but you know, as you can see, it affected me. It was definitely changed the course of my producing. Like, I was not going to ever go back there and do that again. Yeah. You know,
you were talking about a mentor of yours, Ken, what was his name?
Keith Olson.
Okay. And you had told how you had gotten kicked off a record, then asked to come back on as the assistant, which is like, makes me think this guy's a superhero. Who does that? Right. But you said you learned so much watching him because he was very processed.
That's right.
Talk to me about your process and what, like, when you're doing a record, like, you believe like as if it was a workout routine, you have certain beliefs of how that record should be made. Tell me a little bit about your process.
Well, I think at the heart of the whole thing is that we, as our production team, do not need to add more chaos to the process. There's enough chaos. Like, the band comes with an immense amount of drama, ideas. They should, right? That's what they got signed for. So I always say to my guys, we're like the pilots of the plane. They may want to party with us and hang out with us, but they really don't. They want us to fly the plane, you know? So we try to keep everything in there very straightforward so they can be as crazy as they want, knowing there is a routine there, you know? So, you know, we have a daily, we start at 11 o'clock every day and we have a lot of fun. And then by 8 o'clock, we're done. Because after that, like, you know, look, if you want to stay after that, my engineer will stay, but I can't tell what's going on after that, you know? So I think what happened was with Pro Tools, I mean, it really goes back to, I think, Pro Tools, because when I first started using that, there weren't any rock guys using it. I just got into it because an engineer of mine was the guy from Body Count, Bobby Brooks, was a guy who was into that world from pop music. And I remember I used it on the first couple records. And then when you start using Pro Tools, you realize, okay, I'm going to edit all this stuff, or I need an editor. So then somebody, Randy Staub, who had done a record with me, said, hey, you don't need to edit this stuff. There's a guy in Canada that you just send it to him and he sends it back. And I was like, really? So I got that off my plate. And then when I got Mike Plotnikoff, I realized that I really am not that great at miking guitars and stuff. Okay, so that's its own entity. Here's the editing. We got a guitar tech, a drum tech, and all this stuff. And it started looking more like, again, from my engineering background, working on airplanes, you know, you got to design the plane. You got to get a process engineer, which I was, who builds the plane. Then you have to have quality control, you know, which is the A&R department. So you start thinking in terms of aerospace a little bit and how does this work? So, yeah, I mean, it came together kind of like that. And then I realized, wait a second, they could be recording music while I'm doing vocals on the previous record. And Mike does guitars, bass, and drums beforehand, like I want him to. So I don't need to be there for that. Like, honestly, I started realizing that the more I spent time on vocals, the more records I sold. Like, whether they used a Strat, a Les Paul, you know, what kind of amp, nobody cares. You know, like, all they care about is this song good or not? Do I feel something? So I used to say to my artists, look, and they'd be like, well, you know, you're not showing up for the guitars or the drums. And I'm like, yeah, but because all I care about is that if you walk through CVS pharmacy and that song is playing on that little speaker, and what do they hear? They hear the vocal and a bit of the beat. And if they like it, we did our job. And if they hate it, we're fucked. And it doesn't matter how many guitar amps or drum sounds or snares or any of that shit. None of that matters. What matters is the song. And you guys know that. It's the song. It's the story, the feeling. We're selling feelings here. You know, we're not selling perfection. So there's, like, I have an analogy. I say a lot of artists coming in, they get up to bat and they go, we're going to hit that blade of grass in right field, that blade of grass. If we don't hit that blade of grass, it sucks. The record sucks. It has to be that. And I'm like, no, it doesn't. It could be any of those, you know, like there's about 20,000 solutions to this song that all will work. It's just, which one do we want at the moment today? Like, that's why they call it a record. It's a record of now, you know? So you have to loosen up a little bit internally of the process, you know? So if you can get that mindset where, okay, we just did, you know, I'm Not Okay by My Chemical Romance this way, or we did it this way, or we did it this way, and all three results are the same because the song is so great. Now, of course, you don't want to hit the ball out of bounds. There's an out of bounds where things do suck. But trusting Mike and Hatch and Paul and my editors and my great mixer, Chris Sordalgi, I knew I could stay focused on just the top of the pyramid, which was the song and the vocals. I never brought anyone in to do those. I do them all myself in this room, actually. There's a vocal booth over there. So the singer comes up to my house. They get in the vocal booth. We have the track from the studio. I sit in front of the computer, punch. Nobody's involved but me and the singer, because that to me is what it's all about. That's it. That's it. Right.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, super, super. I think we're conditioned to learn so much technology and ability to do all this stuff that we feel compelled that we have to do it all. But the
console's
great,
funny, man. I have people come in and go, what's a console do? And I go, I don't know. Like, I know it's got these rows of things. And, you know, I'm an aerospace engineer. I can tell you, if I thought about it for a second, I'll tell you what it does. But all I know is that Mike knows what it does. And he's great at it. You know, there's the EQ, the busing system, and there's the sends and all that kind of stuff. But I don't, the patch bay, I couldn't patch the thing in if you paid me. You know, I don't know what it does. Like, I know what it does, but I don't know how to do it. Why do I need to know that? You know,
it's not like, in the best interest of the record for you.
It's in a bad interest of the record. Right. And what's really bad is me sitting there watching guitar players play power chords. And, you know, because Mike's got great attention. He's got a great attention span. He can go power chord. Okay, we got to double it. And it's not quite in tune. No, that chord's not quite in tune. I mean, yeah, I'm going to sit there for that. You know, I'm not sitting there for that. So, I mean, why should I? That is only going to make me see none of the canopy at all, at least of the forest. You know?
There were some producers in town in Nashville here that I didn't really think knew what was up. And they were having big hit records. And I was kind of had a lack of respect for them. But in my older age, I gained respect because the outcome was always
Rick's
incredible.
Like that. Rick Rubin. I
learned. You think I'm better than that guy. But then you think, like, wait a minute. The final record that they controlled and that they got to was better than what I was doing by manhandling all these little things.
I learned a lot from watching Rick Rubin. I felt the same way about him. Like, hey, he's producing it out of his roles. How's that possible? You know, but you know what? He only cared about what I care about now. And that's when I started having hits. I was thinking, okay, this guy's only really caring about the songs. He comes in, listens to it, goes yes or no, and leaves. Isn't that what we're being paid for?
Right.
You know,
perspective. Yeah.
It's all the perspective. So
that's hard, though. That's a hard leap for somebody who's been learning the trapeze of how difficult. There's a billion options in the studio. Great producers narrow them down so that you have creativity, but you're headed directly towards an outcome. And it's like, that's a hard process to jump from learning all these little talents that you need to learn over the 30 years, but then being able to be the guy that's like saying, let's streamline this. This is what's important. This is where we're headed, and make sure you don't get off of that path.
Well,
that is
really
the hardest
hard.
Transition.
Talk to the artist about that. You can't.
You can't talk to them. You have to lead them.
You have to lead them. It's like the Jedi mind trick. You have to constantly do that trick with them. You know, you will see this, you know, and so,
you know what it is? Have you ever seen those 3D art pieces where you're looking at them and they all just look like, and then you see them, they go in three-dimensional? It's that kind of epiphany as a producer where you realize sometimes I need to work less hard, push less buttons, have less talk back on the comm while they're doing a vocal. And I need to just allow, this is that moment.
Ray Manzarek said that. Manzarek's great quote was, "We need the doors were really good at letting the muse enter the room." And just by, and Rothschild was a great, I've read a lot of books about him as a producer. And it's good to read about these guys because some of them, him and the old dudes who invented this stuff, they had to go through so much shit. I have those, you guys probably have those old files, from back in the day, like Bohemian Rhapsody and stuff. Mm-hmm. You open these files up and you go, oh my God. Yeah. Like how the hell did they do this on 24 track?
Right.
Freddie Mercury printed to all these tracks and then, what they were doing was mixing in chunks and editing together, and then you realize that they're doing what we're kind of doing in their own way of doing those things, So, hey, this is an hour, right? Because we're almost done.
We're just wrapping up.
Are you guys happy with this so far?
Oh, yeah.
We spent a lot of Rascal Flatts time.
Well, that's a great story.
I remind myself never to talk about Rascal Flatts.
Well, I can tell you that I had a lot of respect for you when I heard that story about you getting kicked off the record as producer and then going back on as an assistant. And I thought to myself, man, I aspire to be a guy like that because you saw value in that. You saw value in what you would learn.
Yeah. And Keith passed away, but I always give him so much credit for not saying no to me that minute. Because I remember when I came back there to get my stuff and I asked him, can I audit this kind of like this process and be your assistant, just learn. And he said, he looked at me for a second. He goes, just the fact that you asked me that is yes. And
so cool.
And I remember when I came in the next day and he was there and the band was shocked to see me back because the band now the great Keith Olsen's producing and I'm under his wing. So they can't get rid of me, And I watched him literally manhandle these guys and it was fun because they needed it, But I was laughing my ass off because I was like, oh my, and they're like asking me, hey, can you do anything about this? I'm like, nope. No.
Well, I know you got some plugins, some Kemper profiles. Where can people find
just two places, the Joey Sturgis stuff. I have a vocal plugin that was incredibly successful. I didn't know what I was going to do, but I just did it based on what I do here. And Joey was patient enough because we did put some crazy things on there, like Volt. Like I thought, what do I do usually here? And then it's a lot. We put a vocal multiplier on there that makes it's almost like gives you additional vocals. You just turn the knob and you get like. And what I did is you see those modular synths behind me. So I modulate the vocals by using sine, square, and different waveforms and using white noise as a chaos producer. So the different, variations are chaotic. So the variations in the vocals are not just pitch and time, and white noise modulating the pitch and time. We're going to put a module out like that later that's standalone because we've had a lot of people, the geeks want us to geek out on this stuff. So we're going to do that. But, it's a typical thing, it's kind of like, vocals, compressor, multiplier, delay, reverb, output. But what I did was just cool. And you guys have noticed from an SSL, I put a button where you can switch the compressor and the EQ around, which, you have to have that, right?
Right.
Because, but that's not on a lot of plugins. So I wanted to have that. It's on the SSL, but it's not on a lot of the stuff that people make. And then the STL Tonality is our guitar plugin I made with Mike Plotnikoff that people seem to love because it's our Bay 7 and West Valley Studios amps and stuff. I mean, there's millions of these things out there, and right. you know, the trick on Plug is to get some people to believe in your stuff and make your customers happy and all that. So
we'll link both of those down in the description. Thank sure. you so much for coming on.
Yeah, it's good interview, man.
And it's just it's good to see how people are making art, in uncompromising art, and knowing what they're willing to walk away from. I mean, this shows a lot of strength, and we appreciate you coming on and sharing that with our audience.
Cool, man. Well, it's good talking to you guys.
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Come on again. It's good fun, you know.
Thank you so much. That's it this week from the West Barn. We'll see you next time.